3, 2, 1.
You're in the wrong channel. Oh no, I'm in the right channel.
There we go.
Okay.
So yeah, you guys are live. Just give me a countdown whenever you're ready.
Okay, I think we can start whenever, so 3, 2, 1, go.
Alright, good luck, man.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks. Alright, welcome guys, this is Banjo-Kazooie. I'm Mittens, and commentating with me is 8-Bit.
8.
So, first things we need to do is tell Bottles that we know all our moves, and that he doesn't need to teach us anything. So, you guys didn't see this, but before this run started, we began to set up a glitch called FFM, and 8-Bit, do you want to explain that a little bit more?
So, if you die in a Furnace Run minigame, it'll basically store all the moves that you had on a file, and then when you start a new file, you can take them over. So he doesn't have all the moves now, but when he enters the first level, he actually will have all of them. Unfortunately, we couldn't show that on the start of the run, because there's a bit of randomness with it, depending on what minigame you get.
Yeah, there are two minigames that you can't die in, and they both take like a minute each, so if we were to try show that on stream, there's a chance we'd waste like up to 7 minutes, like, just trying to get a minigame we could die in.
Yeah. And we actually... we can basically choose whatever moves to take over, and we don't take over blue eggs or red feathers, because if you talk to Bottles to learn them, he gives you the refill, but if you already know them, he doesn't. And as a result, we can't have gold feathers either, because you need to know how to fly to get gold feathers. So basically any move that uses up resources like eggs or feathers, we don't know, but we know all the other moves as soon as we go into Mumbo's.
So now that we're in Mumbo's, you'll notice that I'm just staying in mainly Talentrot, as opposed to that roll flutter cancel that we were doing before in Spiral Mountain. And that's because we have all the moves except for the ones 8-Bit mentioned unlocked. Ah, that one note always trolls me.
So Mumbo's Mountain is fairly standard. It's basically what you'll see in a 100% run, except the only difference is Mittens won't grab any honeycombs, because there's no point getting more health in any percent, it just wastes time. And the way that he's getting up Tika's Tower, usually you're supposed to be the ant, except you can manipulate how the slopes work in this game. So if your shadow goes over flat ground, it basically resets something called the slope timer, and you can spend a little bit longer on the slope. So every time he jumped in between one of those slippery slopes in Tika's Tower, he was jumping across flat ground in between, and that's how he didn't slip off. That's fixed in some versions of the game. In the US, it's fixed in the Japanese version, and it's fixed in the Xbox version. So you have to be a little bit careful about which version you have.
One thing you'll notice as I'm collecting these notes on this hill is I try and keep the camera face towards the wall, and that's just to reduce lag a little bit. And you'll notice on some levels, we'll like use weird camera angles just to kind of help reduce with a little bit of lag, which isn't a major time save, but does help a little bit.
We'll also be seeing a lot of standing where GDs are about to spawn during cutscenes, or skipping the dance entirely, just because each one of those is 4.5 seconds, so any that you can cut off is good.
Uh-huh. that last orange switch Jiggy right there is a good example of, like, predicting where the Jiggy's gonna be and standing in that spot so we can grab it as fast as possible.
You can actually get the Jiggy from the last switch to land on top of the one that Konga throws, and that depends on which direction you attacked the last enemy in. And you can manipulate that and have it happen in a run, and the result is you just see one less Jiggy dance. But you have to rely on those termites being in the right spot to attack, and it's just horrible RNG to deal with, so it's just better to not do that overlap. But the 100% Taz does the overlap.
That was actually a good juju that I had. I'm actually a little surprised by that.
Sometimes even if you shoot the egg into his mouth, it doesn't work if you do it too quickly.
Yeah, it's like the hitbox needs to load.
Yeah. One really good advantage of FFM here is that usually you would have to go up near GG and land ground pound before you went to the conga area. But since we have ground pound from FFM, we could do all the conga stuff before even going near GG to land the move.
Alright, so what I just did there was the a Jiggy Jig skip by grabbing the Jinjo Jiggy, or jumping and grabbing the Jinjo Jiggy and then landing in the water. With that, we're able to basically cancel that animation.
So for people that have played this game casually, you might remember that you need 94 Jiggies and 810 notes to beat the game. So at first glance, it seems like there's not much point to any percent, but there's a few glitches that we can do. We can skip the last door in the game just before Grunty, and that skips 25 Jiggies. And there's another glitch to get into Frizzy Peak early, which saves another 8 Jiggies. So we only actually need 61 Jiggies in this category. So it actually makes any percent quite different from 100%, and it's about 45 minutes shorter. There's also another glitch called RBA, which we aren't using this time. And that is basically where you get the bee out of Click Clock Wood by clipping, and then you don't have to transform back, and you can fly back through the lair as the bee and grab a bunch of notes, basically. And because it doesn't expect you to be flying in most rooms, most levels aren't sealed at the top, or you can get high enough to get into the levels somehow. So that actually cuts out even more Jiggies, and the game can be done with 33 Jiggies in any percent. Unfortunately, RBA is a PAL-only glitch, so it doesn't work on the US versions or Japanese versions. There is a way to do it on those versions, but it's slower and it ends up not being worth it. It's also a lot more difficult. So there's two any percent categories, any percent and any percent no RBA. And which category people run kind of depends on where they live and what version they have. And you tend to see a lot more people running no RBA, just because it's more accessible to more people. So yeah, this category will get 61 Jiggies and 810 notes, and any percent gets 33 Jiggies and 810 notes. There's only about 8 minutes of difference between the two, though. Sorry, go on.
I was just gonna say, it's good to note, because, like, the notes are the limit, or, like, the hard thing to grab enough of in this category. You'll see a lot of times where we go into, like, a room just to grab 4 notes, like we did right there with the sandcastle.
Yeah. Those notes are so slow that you have to get them.
They're faster than any other 4 notes, so...
Yeah. And because you need 810 notes to beat the game, and there's 9 levels with 100 notes in each level, you have to go into all the levels. So the notes are the real bottleneck in this category.
If we ever found a skip for the 810 note door, though, we'd only have to collect 230 notes, which is... Well, I guess not in this category. Never mind. You'd still have to collect 765. But you could at least skip one level, possibly.
Yeah, and... Yeah, and 80% you'd only have to get 260, because you can skip all the other note doors leading up to 810, except for the 810 note door. But nobody's found a way to skip the 810 note door, and we've looked for it pretty hard.
So in this category, we only need 20 Mumbo tokens. So luckily there's like plenty of Mumbo tokens around that we don't really have to think about it, but you'll see me grabbing a few of them. The really convenient ones.
Yeah, this category walks past a lot of really quick Mumbo tokens, just because it doesn't need many at all. So, Treasure Trove Cove, you can play a bit differently because you have Big Bum, so there's going to be lots of Big Bums everywhere that you couldn't do if you didn't use FFM, which was the move glitch at the start.
It's also good to note that we don't have a Jiggy Jig when you grab Jiggies in flight. So any Jiggies we can grab in flight, we'll try to do so.
This is the first level that starts to look a bit different from 100%. There's a few really slow jiggies in this level. And since we can skip, what, 39 of them?
Yeah.
You cut out some of the slow ones. So, Mins won't get the X marks the spot jiggy or the jiggy in the sandcastle. And what he did there was a quick dive, so if you're getting out of the talent shot animation, it kind of interrupts the fact that you're entering the water, and then you fall down a lot further than you're supposed to. So a lot of the time when he wants to dive deep into the water really quickly, he'll slide off the edge in talent shot and then exit talent shot and fall down really far rather than having to swim down.
Oh, that was bad. Landing on that alcove jiggy there is normally going to be a reset, but that's okay. It happens. It's a marathon.
Yeah, it's a lot harder than it looks to not land on those jiggies. And there's quite a few of them that you have to not land on as well. At the end of the day, it's only about 40 seconds lost there.
Alright, this jump to the green Jinjo is actually really scary, because you can't really see where the Jinjo is. I would have done it right. I need to apologize for anyone who has OCD, because we finished this level with 99 out of 100 notes, so sorry if that like bugs any of you guys. There's one note in an alcove that's really far out of the way, or it's just really inconvenient to grab, so we just avoid it.
Yeah. It can be quite difficult to figure out which notes to skip, because they're often in bunches of certain numbers, and if you can only skip... If you want to skip, say, two notes, it's really hard to find a bunch of two notes to skip. It's actually very difficult to route any percent categories.
Just because you have so many options as far as like what to grab and what not to grab? Is that why? Yeah.
I mean, in 100% you have to grab it all, so it's just figuring out the quickest way to do that.
True.
There's so many more possibilities. I recently discovered glitch was Clanker's Cavern Early, but unfortunately it's tool-assisted speedrun, so you can't do it.
It's not RTA viable.
RTA runs, yeah. And on top of that, it only works on PAL, so even if you could do it, then...
I'd have to move to Europe to do it. And or Australia.
Yeah. Yeah, then this category would probably be run on PAL as well.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Often PAL categories are slower. Often PAL games are slower, but some games incorporate code to speed it up and keep it the same as NTSC. And this game is one of those. It's not perfect, but it's pretty close.
Alright, I actually got the jump at the beginning of Clankers, which that's actually a deceptively hard jump to get on top of the pipes versus having to climb a ladder to get up there.
That's a similar glitch to the one in Mumbo's Mountain with Tickers Tower.
Where you let your shadow go over flat ground to reset the slope timer.
Yeah.
Did not get the Phantom Bubble, though. Shit.
Yeah, that key can have a really bad hitbox if you turn around too fast.
It's funny, that's like one of the longest cutscenes that we actually watch in this game. In this category, at least.
Yeah. Me and Mittens both like any percent because it just has a lot less cutscenes, and 100% feels a bit more fast-paced.
Yeah.
People who like 100%.
Yeah. You also
people like 100%, this is a bit better.
You also don't have, like, there are mini-games in 100% that you have to do that, like, take, like, 3 minutes each, which is just annoying. Oh, please make this. There we go. Alright. Only lost a cycle. So this is more relevant in 100% than any percent. But this level does operate on cycles. So, like, Clanker raises up and down the water with, like, a certain timing. So there's only certain times you can enter him. Like when the blowhole goes up, for instance. I'm going to want to take one hit of damage on these saw blades, if I can. There we go. To set up for a death warp later on.
So, you can actually run through all the saw blades without taking any damage, except that we want to take some damage in this category. All you have to do is run on the little seam on the right-hand side in the corner, like he does on the way back. And it's funny because I always forget that's actually a glitch because it just seems so common now. You are supposed to use gold feathers to get through there.
Yeah, so right now we actually have every move in the game after only the first three levels, which is kind of cool if you think about it. Uh-oh. That was bad. Alright. There's not like a whole lot to say about this level, honestly. It's mainly just going through and collecting all the notes and most of the notes and most of the jiggies. No especially hard tricks.
The strange thing about it is, if you save time, it's always in multiples of 10 seconds because of all the cycles.
Yeah.
Unless you mess up something inside Quenka, because that's not based on cycles. But, like, as soon as you enter the level, where Gloop is that will spit the bubbles, that depends on the cycle. And even where Clanker's bolt is, because his bolt flies up and then back down again. That cycle actually starts going from when you enter the level. And you would think it starts from when you turn the key and raise him up, but it just doesn't.
It's interesting, it feels like every level in this game has its own challenges. Like, for Treasure Trove Cove, it's like flying sections. It has the most flying sections in the game and the most technical flying sections. For this level, it's cycles. No other game really has, or level has cycles like Clanker's does. On the next level, it's gonna be health management, as you'll see. Which is actually one of those things I think I like about this category, is that each level is kind of a little bit different in how you have to approach it.
Yeah, I have to agree with that for this category. Luckily, in any percent, some of the levels. Some of the levels are done as the B, which is hard for a lot of people, and then easy for others, so I find that the earlier levels are the harder ones in any percent, which is weird because the later levels are supposed to be harder. But in this category, they're all equally hard, I reckon.
The clock wood is easy.
Yeah, if you don't fall off.
Fair enough.
Yeah, like Mad Monster Mansion, I really like that. And Click Clock Wood.
One nice thing about only having 5 health throughout the speedrun is we're able to perform death warps really quickly, or set up for death warps really quickly. So a lot of times I'll just do it at like specific parts during the run and like not really have to think too much about it. Sometimes in 100%, if you want a death warp, you have to take damage on a whole bunch of different balls and enemies and stuff. So that's one nice other thing about this category.
Yeah, so he was thinking about that death warp from the moment he talked to Bottles. And that's why he wanted to take damage on the fans. Mm-hmm. But it is nice if you accidentally have too much health. It's not too hard to lose 5 health. Whereas in 100%, it can be really slow. But the annoying thing about routing Clanker's Cavern is that Bottles restores your health when he teaches you gold feathers. So, yeah, if you talk to him towards the end of the level, it can be really hard to take enough damage before you have to do the death warp.
That happens in 8%, doesn't it? You talk to him kind of near the end.
You can still take a bit of damage, so.
I have to actually say, I think Bubble Gloop Swamp is one of my two favorite levels in this category, at least.
A lot of people have trouble with Bubble Gloop Swamp, though, because you have to run through all the swamp water, which hurts you, if you want to go fast through the level. And with only 5 health, that can be really challenging.
Oh shoot. Alright, I did not actually want to take damage there. Okay.
There's a couple of frogs. Across from the egg anyway. Yeah.
Yeah, I just want to hit the egg cycle. Yeah, bad movement. Alright, normally you have 2 health coming out of the swamp there. So hopefully I can take the bow to shame. I'll hit a good cycle with it. It'll be okay. Yeah, so if you don't have good swamp movement like I just had right there, like bad swamp movement like I just had, you'll have to ride that boat.
Was that camera zoomed or did you spike there?
No, I just accidentally pressed the button.
Sometimes we'll like zoom it in or flip it around to reduce lag. I think Min's mentioned that in Mumbo's Mountain.
Yeah. This level's a little hard, especially right here, because you're like in the very middle of the level. So basically anywhere you look, it lags a little bit.
Now he's finally gonna restore his health.
Yeah, this Jiggy is actually wonderful, not because it gives you a Jiggy and it's pretty fast, but because it drops so much health for you.
So, yeah, it's even more important in this category to land on that Jiggy during the... well, to have that Jiggy land on you during the cutscene. In 100%, it is quicker to stand where it is during the cutscene, but if you miss it, you can come back as the crocodile and grab it and skip the dance. In this category, we don't even turn into the crocodile, so you'd waste 4.5 seconds if you missed it. Or maybe a little bit less, but roughly that. And we skip the Croctus Jiggy in this category, firstly because it has a few cutscenes and it's a bit slow, but it also skipping it allows the route to open up more for this level because it's not dictated by where the Croctus spawns. And he was jumping up those huts without breaking them to get the shock spring pad, which is actually a bit harder than it looks.
Yeah, you have to be standing right on the very peak of them in order to get your jump high enough to make it up to the next level. In fact, if you notice, there was one that I did break, and that's because that one is a little bit too hard to get.
Down to 1 health again, which is a common theme for this level.
Yeah, crossing over tiny logs in swamp water with 1 health.
Yeah. And this level has the first examples of some really long jiggies that we skip. like the Turtle Choir and Mr. Vile. Together, those jiggies are probably 5 or 6 minutes, so it definitely saves a lot of time. And once we get into Clicklockwood, we don't actually need any jiggies at all. So you get 0 out of 11 jiggies. 11 because there's the witch jiggy as well. So it's more like you have to find, I guess 29 jiggies to skip rather than 30. Yeah, 28 jiggies to skip rather than 39 jiggies.
Alright, the second pair of waiting boots here is actually very critical that I don't mess up my movement. So I can grab that last note and jump back towards here so I don't take any damage.
It's quite an interesting route because he actually left one note at the end of the maze. And it's just kind of weird that that note is so close to you, but it takes so much time to get because of the waiting boots and damage.
Alright, I need 3 notes. That's actually really bad. I think I'm just gonna wait towards the end to grab those. Actually, I know what I'll do.
Well, you need 3 more notes.
Yeah. I don't know what's up with me in the swamp movement today.
Yeah, it can go bad so quickly.
Yeah. Luckily, there's
3 notes are you gonna get?
I think I'm gonna do skip the snare bear and click clock the final snare bear and click clock wood and go into Mumbo's hut instead, and then also grab the notes in the well area in Mad Monster Mansion.
So normally you're supposed to drop down from the room above this to get this jiggy. With a precise jump you can get in the hat like that. And Mittens is going to do a glitch to get into the next level, appropriately titled for ZZP Curly. And that's a clip that you do while flying, and you actually need Beak Bomb to do the clip. And you get Beak Bomb in for ZZP. So before FFM, for ZZP Curly wasn't a thing, but since he has Beak Bomb now, he can get into it. So it's a bit surprising, but having all the moves actually saves 8 more jiggies in this category.
I'm gonna grab this jiggy now, so I don't forget it.
And for ZZP, Curly is notorious for being very difficult. And it matters if you miss it, because you have to spawn the fly pad again and it takes another 40 seconds. But Mittens has put in a lot of work to finding a good setup for it, so hopefully it shouldn't be too much of an issue. That being said, it's still very difficult.
We say that now and then watch it, we'll miss it a million times. That's marathon luck for you, right?
Yeah.
Hope not.
It's also very different between Talon and TSC. Just to reiterate, that's between US and Europe. And Mittens is better at the NTSC one and I'm better at the PAL one. So we disagree on which one's actually harder.
I should have gone for the Beak Bomb into there. Oh well, we still got it.
Ha ha! I don't think that beak bomb would have been marathon safe.
Yeah. No, we gotta go fast. We've already lost time. We need a world record this.
I only do that beak bomb if I'm like 2 minutes behind. So you can do a second beak bomb into Frazzy Peak, but you've gotta kind of get under the door, but also go high enough that you hit the loading zone, so it's pretty precise.
Yeah, it's a very small margin for error there.
Yeah. I mean, it's not too bad, but after you've got that really hard clip, it's not something that you want to do. And it's, like, probably a minute if you lose it.
Oh, I got tons of feathers. Alright. Alright, I think this is the first level we're actually going to collect all the notes on.
This level is a bit annoying to route in no RBA because you've got to get the Boggy Jiggy and it sends you down from the top of the snowman that really breaks up the route a lot.
Alright, we're not having a good time with that Jiggy today.
Oh well. Yeah, with that first beak bomb into the pipe, you can grab the Jiggy by beak bombing into it, but sometimes it just doesn't work.
Yeah, I think I was a little too far away from it when I did the beak bomb.
Yeah.
Because normally I like getting like right next to it. That seems to be more reliable. Right. Boggy likes talking to us, but we like avoiding him, so jump around him.
Yeah, this level's quite strange in that all the notes are pretty fast, but the G's are just really slow. So I think we only got 3 Jiggies in this category in this level.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Skip all the buggy races and turning into the Warrus and stuff. Beak bombing all the snowmen. All those are just too slow.
Right. This jump is the biggest troll in the world right here. Right. I've been trying to figure out how to get that jump to be consistent, and there's just, like, no way.
I liked your idea of looking at the wall.
Yeah, that seemed to help a little bit, but it's also kind of a pain to, like, turn your camera around.
Yeah. It's also a pain to miss the jump, though. So even though it looks like he's really low on feathers right now, he's going to grab one in between every note on this scarf, so it really, from this point in the run, you can stop thinking about your feather count, because you got so many here.
And also there's only one more flight section that is actually in the game, so before the final fight, so we're not going to be using too many feathers.
Yeah.
Basically, all the feathers we have right now are all we have to complete the game with. Alright, these snowmen here, sometimes they have really good aim, and sometimes they have really bad aim. So let's hope today they have really bad aim.
Something people don't know is you can actually get health from the snowballs if you either bear punch them or ground pound them. And that comes in really handy if you take too much damage in that icy water.
Can also be tricky though, because normally if you take too much damage you're at 1 health, so if you get hit by the snowball you die.
Yeah. But all the other health is so far away that it's about the only thing you can do.
To exit there, you notice that I did a beak barge into the flame, And that's to hit us in an angle that will throw us in front of Mumbo to wake him up, so we can cancel text while we death warp, versus having to do it, like waste 3 seconds to cancel it normally.
Yeah, that was another mitten set up, that one. I like it. Before we had that set up, though, it was just you had to jump onto the flame and hope that you get hit towards Mumbo. And the flames have a really bad hitbox. You can be standing on the pole and not get hurt sometimes. So while we got this bit of lair progression, I'm going to talk about a trick right at the end of the run, and that's called Door of Grunty Skip. So I briefly mentioned it earlier, and you can use it to skip 25 jiggies, and you don't have to open that very last door just before the Grunty fight. So what happens is you walk on the seam on the stairs, and you clip through just by walking into it. And then once you clip through, you can jump out of it, get out of bounds, and then jump around the door. And it's a very difficult glitch. You've only got 4 frames to make the jump, and that means that that's roughly 4/60ths of a second to make the jump. So it's very precise, and on top of that, there's a lot of lag near the door, so when you clip is also inconsistent. A lot of people have tried to find good setups for it, and it's just ridiculously hard to get it consistently. So that's a really scary part of the run, because it's right at the end, and it's just bad, because it's right at the end, and you can lose several minutes to it if it doesn't cooperate. But I thought I'll mention it now, because I'm sure Mittens will get it first try, and I won't have time to explain why it's so difficult.
Let's hope so.
Yeah, it's not just the fact that it's frame perfect, it's the fact that it's so inconsistent.
Yeah,
and you have to jump it. Yeah.
And you also have to, like, actually input the correct, like, angles on your control stick in order to get it, and react to, like, when you actually clip out of bounds. It's a little difficult. That's probably an understatement.
You get the clip. Yeah, so we won't see that to the end, but it's a bit complicated, so. Yeah.
Alright. So this level is quite a bit of the way out of the way. But we have to visit it, A, because we need to visit every level to get enough notes to complete the game, and B, because we actually have to turn into the pumpkin to raise the water in the lair. So that's actually another bottleneck of these games, is we have to visit this level in order to progress further into the lair.
Yeah, so in this category it doesn't make heaps of difference that you have to raise the water, but in any percent you have to go into this level before you can even get to Click Clockwood. So if we didn't have to, we could probably clip into this level as the bee and then skip 10 more jiggies, but just because you can't get to Click Clockwood without raising the water, you can't do that. In this category it's more just an annoying cutscene bit.
You see that fall damage I took on the cellar door?
That was so weird. And he ground pounded before it as well.
Yeah, it was actually kind of hilarious. I liked that.
So it seems like it might be a good idea to skip gold feathers in this category, because you don't really need them. But
they make flibbits nice.
As you see, he used it. Sir?
They make flibbits nice.
Yeah, flibbits in this category is a big one. And also the snare bears in Click Clockwood.
Mm-hmm.
So it's possible to do it without gold feathers, but it saves a lot of time to do it with gold feathers, and it's a lot safer. And, for example, in the cellar there, he used a gold feather to get through the door and get to the jiggy a bit quicker. So there's just little optimizations like that. So on the roof of Tumblr there was an example of how the sleep timer works. So I think because Mitten's ground pounded over the top of it, his shadow was over the slope. And when he shadows over the slope, it counts up to 1 second. And if it hits 1 second, you just slip off the slope. So unfortunately, he slid down after that ground pound. But the hedge saved him.
Entering that second window, you'll notice that I actually didn't look at the window. And that's because if you look at the window, the entire level's behind you. And it lags the game really badly.
I never thought about that one. That's a good one.
Yeah, that one's really noticeable, like lag wise.
Yeah. Yeah, so with the slope timer thing getting onto roofs, one part where you can really notice it casually is in Click Clock Wood on the. On the house in winter, there's some notes on the roof, and it's really hard to get up there because you high jump, and then you high jump onto the roof, and your shadow's over the roof, which is slippery, and if it's there for over a second, you just slip off straight away before you can get into Talon's Drop.
Collecting these notes in this maids in this order actually lock that first ghost into the hedge like that, so we don't have to actually, like, worry about him. It's, like, an interesting, actually pretty consistent thing of this category. Jumped to the wrong part of the hedge. My egg hit the ripper instead of the gold feather. Kind of annoying.
Hitboxes on those pots are awful.
They are the worst.
So something you did with that jiggy on top of the church roof is he ground pounded underneath it, and when he ground pound, Banjo actually goes a little bit upwards before he goes down. And he goes up just enough to grab the jiggy. So you can use it to grab, get a bit of extra height like that. Another place which I didn't mention was in Treasure Trove Cave, when he's leaving part of the ship and there's a loading zone above him. He just jumps and then ground pounds, and the ground pound height makes him go through. A lot of cool little things you can do like that.
Yeah, this game, there's not too many hard tricks in, this category in any percent, there's more than 100%, but other than that, basically everything, other than like two tricks, everything is mainly movement based. So small optimizations like ground pounding to get a little extra height can like really actually build up and save you some time. This is one of the slower jiggies that we have to grab in this category.
Yeah, I think this jiggy and the one in the underwater piping clanker's cavern, those are the two slowest ones. And kind of a recent development in Mad Monster Mansion is we actually found out it's quicker to get all the stuff around the well as the pumpkin. So we used to do it as Banjo and just swim through and grab the notes in the jiggy. But yeah, it's quite recent. We do it as a pumpkin now. And use this fancy little jump to get across there without breaking the gate.
Eh, come on. All right, now we're only one note short.
The funny thing about that gravestone is he hits you on NTSC, but not on PAL. There's lots of little physics differences.
I've had him not hit me on NTSC before, but it's very rare for me, at least.
I think some runners have figured out how to not get hit there, but it's just not big enough that people really talk about it.
As Ghost.
Doesn't really matter that he took damage there, because I think he's going to do a reset now. Yep.
That Bible Thump Ween emote is perfect for that level of Banjo. Cute little pumpkin with a face. Alright, that's the only reset we do in this game. Simply because it takes a really long time to walk back through the lair as the pumpkin.
It's actually, yeah, it's a little bit slower. If we didn't need the jiggy from Plankers' cabin that he's about to get now, it would actually be quicker to not reset there. This category goes to Gobi's Valley now, and no other categories go to Gobi's Valley now. So I think even if he didn't need that jiggy, it would still be quicker to reset.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's very close, though. And it's a difficult thing to time as well.
I thought that guy was going to hit me, so I decided to ground pound him.
Yeah, he can be in the worst spot sometimes.
Yeah.
So this is going to be another level where health management is really important, because of all the sand.
Actually, this one's kind of interesting, because health management's really important at the very beginning, but then after a certain point, it, like, honestly doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Which is odd.
Except that after that point you do basically the whole level on one health and it's really intense.
You need that fast death warp. Gotta do it on one health.
Yeah. One very good thing about this category is you don't do Gobi Clip. So for people who have watched 100% runs, you can get into,
Binksy.
Yeah, without, tuning eggs into his nose. But there's no reason to go in there, because it's just really slow in this category. And the clip to get into Jinxy is, like, really difficult to pull off consistently. On PAL it's a little bit easier, but here it's just hard. So it's a bit of a run killer.
You'll notice that for grab his Jiggy, I was able to beak bomb it away from him. Normally you're supposed to grab the running shoes to get that Jiggy, but we don't have time for that.
The running shoes aren't fast enough.
Oh god. I normally enter this room as Banjo, so... I know the cycle in the basket. Oh my god, wait. What? I think I just screwed up, like, big time. Alright, no, we're good.
Oh no. Oh. Thank goodness.
That was a little scary.
Yeah. Do you need more eggs for something soon?
No, I think we're okay. Because I think by the time I need them, I'll have collected a few more.
Okay. Yeah, it's quite a cool feature that if you poop out an egg and then touch it again, you can grab it again. I think that what the Taz does is, in Rusty Market Bay, it wants to break the windows on the ship with an egg. But what it does is it poops an egg onto the window, and then it kind of grabs the egg as it's breaking the window, so it uses an egg without really using the egg.
That was a bad slope climb.
Yeah, you'll notice that he, when he was climbing that slope, he jumped out over the sand again. That was to reset that timer.
Alright, we can do this.
A health one in a really weird way.
Yeah. Like, flew backwards.
I think it hit the tree.
Oh, is that what happened?
Yeah.
Alright. Alright, 2 health. That's exactly what we want to be at.
Time is really tight, and it's even worse when you get all the notes.
Yeah, the timer is actually inaccurate on emulator and Xbox, so it's actually like even more tight on those systems than it is on N64.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird one because it hit zero on the door. It's a very long time to close.
Yeah.
I find it funny how you don't grab that one Mumbo token after walking out of the water thing.
We don't need it. I wish we could avoid this Mumbo token at the bottom of the moat here, too. It's the only Mumbo token we actually have to grab, because it's faster.
So these notes are probably the slowest notes in the category. So if we found 6 notes that were quicker, they would be in instead.
Oh shoot.
Oh, he's in a bad spot.
Oh my god. Oh well.
Do you have left?
I have quite a few.
How many do you, like, if, because you can get...
We can get the notes on this level pretty quick, I think. Here, okay. Let's just, we'll just do it. Rip.
I was gonna say, you can get a few at the top in autumn. Like, 7 plus 4 plus 3. No, 8 plus 4 plus 3 even.
That's okay. Without the Jiggies, this level's not too bad. There's quite a few that we missed there, so...
Okay.
Alright, sit tight, guys. We'll catch back up to where we were.
so that's... Yeah, that's the difficult thing about this game. If you die, you have to get all the notes in the level again. It's not like that on the Xbox version, though.
No. Should have been running on Xbox.
Good one. The Xbox version isn't. Some people run on it, but it is slower because a lot of the text you can't skip on Xbox.
You also can't really do any percent very well on it because they don't have a reliable way of doing the dog skip at the end. So they have to collect 25 extra jiggies, basically.
Yeah, 94 jiggy, any percent no LVA.
Yeah. Alright, I don't actually even have to...
And I could do FPA, like... Yeah, I was gonna say, you could go in the bottom door of the water temple.
Yeah, I'm going to. I just need to grab these notes.
I wonder if you can take your running shoes in there.
I don't know, that's a good question. I don't think you can. Let's find out. Oh, you can. Interesting. Now that I'm done being stupid. Well, let's get past that scabby first, and then I can say that.
Yeah, the quick dives that he's doing become a lot more important in this part. Because he drops right from that stair and drops all the way, almost all the way down to the bottom. Actually, if you do drop all the way down to the bottom, because you're not swimming yet, it thinks that the ground is still gonna hurt you, so you take damage.
Did I miss some notes somewhere? Oh, the ones in the sand. Oh shit. Alright.
In the sand.
Wading boots ones. I just climbed Jinxie, I didn't.
Ah, yeah. Yeah.
But I was like, my note count's not right. That's okay, we can beak bomb to Gobi that way.
At least that's all the notes now.
Back on track.
Now you notice that he actually beak bombed downwards even though his nose was pointing up there. That's because the direction of the beak bomb actually depends on where the camera is facing, not where Banjo is facing. It was the same sort of thing for the FPL clip. That can be a bit counterintuitive when you start running out there.
Yeah, for sure. There's no Jiggy Jig animation when you grab Jiggies with the running shoes on. So, we actually use the slope there to jump on that tree to jump over to the Trunker Jiggy, so we can skip the Jiggy Jig. Alright, on to the best level. The one we've all been waiting for.
So now that he's raised the water level, he can actually get up to this level. There's no way up there if you don't do it there. Now jump to the box with the water level switch inside it is actually a pretty tight jump to do.
Alright, this level is actually really scary, health-wise, so we're gonna fill up before we go in. So the reason why this level's so scary health-wise is there's a whole bunch of these enemies that jump out of these grates at you, and they all do 2 damage. So with us only having 5 health, 3 hits from those guys and we're dead, so we gotta be extra careful.
This level's, like, even worse with those is the B, because with the B, you can't attack anything to get more health. But there's like a different set of challenges with Banjo, because you've got the engine room with him, and it's really easy to fall off.
So this room is notorious, especially among speedrunners, for killing runs. If you fall into the pit here, you actually die and lose all your notes, and have to do the entire level over again. So, let's try to not do that.
That's also another reason that we do it right at the start as well. Works out to be quick that way, but also, I mean, if you die and have to do it again, you can get back pretty quickly. If we did it at the end, then if you died in the engine room, you'd have to get all the notes again. He's only got 20 so far, though. That's sort of a new strat that he's doing there, talent trotting through the fans. Usually we just do that on foot, but it would be quicker to talent trot through. It's a bit riskier.
Yeah, that first fan you always get double tapped almost if you do talent trot.
Wow. That was close. If that second fan had hit him again, he would have got knocked off. Got a nice little clip here. That clip feels pretty random sometimes, so that was pretty good.
The window one?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's a really strange clip.
I cannot get that clip in Talent Trot. I know some people can, but for me, I always have to do it as Banjo.
I had a lot of trouble getting it on PAL when I ran 100%. But NTSC felt a little bit better. I could just be imagining that though. And this water, when you're underneath it, takes twice as much air, and when you're on the surface it takes the regular amount of air. Whereas usually if you're on the surface, you get all your air back. So that's a little bit scary, but you're not under the water too much in this level, so you don't have to worry about it really.
Alright, this second crate that we're going to be going into here is the single most scary room in this entire level. If you notice, we're at 2 health right now, which is actually pretty normal. And up here, we have to grab these notes, and they're all lined with these enemies that do 2 damage to you. So I'm going to kind of do baby strats here. Alright, perfect. So one hit from those guys would have actually made us have to redo the entire level over again.
Yeah, you can jump past the wind tunnel trap, but it's really inconsistent. It's worth it if you got 3 health, but no way if you're gonna die.
I'm gonna go for lifeboat jump. Why not? Nope, didn't make it. Alright. That'll teach me for going for hard strats.
So what he was trying to do there was jump to the lifeboat, so instead of climbing the crane and going across, you just jump straight to the lifeboat and jump across to the jiggy. It doesn't save a lot of time, but yeah, it can be really bad if you miss it.
Yeah, so there's like 4 seconds if you get it and like 40 seconds if you miss it, so God damn it. Alright.
Oh. Alright.
Yeah, I haven't...
How many more nights did you have?
A lot.
Alright.
Alright, hopefully I don't go overestimate now. I think we're okay.
You could do something like skip the fall behind the fans and engine room and go to Zabba's or something.
Well, the issue is that if I skip that, I need 5 notes. Right?
Yeah, but then you'd also go to Mumbo's.
Yeah, that's true. Alright, yeah, we can do Zabba's.
You just don't want to risk those fans again.
Wait, but Zabba's isn't fall.
Yeah. Not that high up.
Alright, we'll do it.
I don't know where you death warp. I'm sure you'll find a spot.
I may start with Zubba's.
Yeah. That one cog that no speedrunners ever go over.
Alright, let's go fast.
Good clip again.
Thank you. Oh, I really want to skip these 4 notes too. Well, we'll get them.
Probably take your totals after Click Clock Wood, because you change heaps of notes.
Actually, I don't know if I can Death Warp. I might have died too many times.
Well, you can grab the extra life near the Click Clock Wood puzzle.
Oh yeah, I could do that.
But you'd have 0 lives going into Furnace Fun otherwise.
Yeah. Wouldn't be the first time I've done that.
It wouldn't be very fun.
No. That'd be the run that I'd get a bunch of Grundy questions on, like, the Joker Square and stuff.
Thank you.
Alright.
Oh, you got it. Nice.
Yeah. The issue is I've been going for that, so I kind of forgot, like, the timing on the flutter for the other way. As stupid as that sounds.
Yeah, my issue with lifeboat jump is whenever I get it, I'm so surprised that I actually lose time.
Alright, I have a little bit too much health. Perfect. Alright, this level is now officially the worst level now. In my book. After today. Just kidding. I still like it. Well, I've never actually seen someone actually hit the button.
Yeah, if you get the thing where Banjo goes up on his ground pound at the same time that it locks your movement, he flies up really high for some reason. People like to go for that because it doesn't cost any time or save any time, but it's just a cool thing. That's a cool little damage boost on that drill chomper.
I'm dumb.
So that. Oh, he's supposed to death warp.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's okay. You're good.
What category were you thinking of?
I don't know. It must have been 100%. I'm like super flustered right now. Alright. One level left though.
So, yeah, he was. With that grill jumper, he jumped up to it in Talentron and knocked him up onto the box. Usually you'd have to get out of Talentron and high jump up there. But it's just one of those little things that saves a bit of time, and he needed to take damage anyway.
I'm gonna do this, because why not?
What, 640 skip?
Yeah.
Okay. They have 640 nodes, and you're supposed to in no RBA, but in any percent you'd do this trick to skip the 640 note door. And it's a cool glitch to show off.
If I can get it. There we go.
Nice. Yeah, I'm pretty glad you shared that one.
Might as well.
Alright, so you need 5 more notes and click lock with, I guess.
I might just climb Summer.
Oh, do you not climb Summer in no RBA?
Not up to those like 5 notes outside nab nuts or whatever.
Okay. Remember you're a bit low on gold for this, I think.
That's fine. Yeah, I mean anything's gonna be quite a ways off.
Yeah, so that jump up to the leaf that he did there is pretty difficult. I don't know why they put a leaf there that you can't really jump up onto. I don't know what they were really thinking about. But...
Aesthetics.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, it's handy for the speed run. Saves about 20 seconds climbing up the other leaves.
Yeah, they should just put leaves everywhere. Make speedrun the game easy.
When he jumped into that cauldron during, like, he jumped into the cauldron as it was activating. So for some reason, when that happens during the cutscene, Banjo's standing next to the cauldron, and usually Banjo would not be there at all. And if there's a glitch that you can do with two of the cauldrons in this game, and if you kind of activate them at the same time, don't forget to grab the extra life, by the way.
Yeah, I will.
If you activate them at the same time, then Banjo actually goes to where he would be during that weird cutscene.
Wait, where is the extra life?
It's near Bryntilda, like to the right of Bryntilda.
Oh. Oh, I see, over here.
Yeah.
Shows you how often I grab that thing.
Are you not talking to Bryntilda?
Nah.
Okay. So, some runners will talk to Bryntilda there, because... So there's a quiz at the end of the game, Furnace Fun, and Grunty asks you personal questions about herself during the quiz, and the answers are actually randomly generated each time you start a new... Well, not when you start a new file, but each file has different randomly generated answers. So there's a lot of RNG during that quiz, and there's only 256 possible combinations of answers that you could get, and based on, like, when you start answering questions, based on which ones you get right or wrong, you can kind of narrow down the number of possible patterns that are left. And there's actually a calculator that you put in the answers that you've either got right or wrong or heard from Bryntilda, and it narrows down the pattern numbers for you, and eventually you just get which pattern you have, even if you haven't answered all the questions. So that cuts down a lot of RNG, but you can still get some answers wrong. Usually it's about, like, anywhere between 0 and 4 per run that you get wrong. Maybe more if you don't talk to Bryntilda. And if you get a Grunty question on a Joker Square or a Death Square, then you basically have to redo Furnace Fun. So that's probably one of the most annoying things about Banjo speedrunning, and there's no real way around it. But the calculator helps a lot.
I should be okay with that one up, because if something does go wrong, knock on wood, it won't be too bad.
Yep.
Let's hope.
So, yeah, Click-Clock Wood, even though it's usually the longest level, it's not going to be as long in this category, because you don't need any jiggies, so you go past less notes, so you actually don't get heaps of notes in this level. I think somewhere around 70 notes, I'm not 100% sure.
Normally get 58 notes.
Oh, even less.
Yeah.
Yeah. 58 notes. And we're going to be getting 63 in this run.
Wait. What am I doing? This isn't summer, this is spring. I've had that guy troll me really badly before. So we're not even gonna mess with him.
Yeah, sometimes if that guy's really far away when you hit the switch, when you come back after the cutscene, he can be completely in a different spot and be right over where you are and not here.
Yeah, I've definitely had that happen before. If you fall off that spot and you're not at full health, it's insta-death, so... it's a little annoying.
Yeah, it's pretty frustrating. The other thing that can happen is you can ground pound off that switch like you did there, and if you hit the enemy on the ground, just before you hit the ground, then you take a lot of full damage and die. So that's really risky. But the chance of that happening is pretty low, just based on where the enemy could be. I guess something we didn't really explain is after that switch, he kind of ground pounded where it was and then fell off the edge during the recoil after the ground pound. And you're actually invincible during that recoil time, which is why he could do that. So, yeah. That just stops him from taking full damage.
Alright, we're gonna do Bappy strats here. Everything else has gone wrong in the speedrun. The back part of those snare bear enemies actually don't have a hitbox to them, so you can actually jump on the back parts of them and be okay.
I can't believe you did that jump just then.
It's a safe jump.
It is not a safe jump. I don't think I've ever done that jump in a run and lived.
Alright, we're gonna help Nadia on her way back.
So even though we don't need the Jiggy from Naughty, there's two notes behind those boulders when we break it in summer. So they're a pretty quick two notes to get, because you have to come down here to hit the switch for autumn, and then the boulder's right there on your way back, so you might as well.
By using a gold feather on it, it breaks it the first frame of the gold feather animation, versus any other way of breaking it, which takes a few frames.
Plus you don't get knocked around when it breaks.
Right. No, actually, that rock and the rock that Gobi's tied to are really nice to break with gold feathers.
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool. I never thought about that. That it would break on the first frame.
Yeah, it's like everything else, because it's either gold feathers, beak barge, which has that build-up animation, or beak bust, which also kind of has like a build-up animation, so... I should be good on notes now, once I complete this level. So if we collected enough notes, hopefully, we'll be at 810 when you enter the store. And we are, so we're good.
That was very brave, not checking your notes before you died in Click Clock Wood.
I checked them before I entered Click Clock Wood, so I kind of knew that we were good.
Because I guess you can check them at the 640 note door.
Yeah, but we skipped it. I like literally just had to pause and check. Yeah.
Okay.
So. I did it quick. No one noticed.
Yeah, I missed it. So we do this grunty question here. So this is one of those random ones. And we do it here because there's a Joker square coming up that we absolutely need to get right. So if we do a grunty question now, we can kind of narrow down that number of possible patterns before we attempt the Joker square. Just in case we get a grunty question on the Joker square. Because the Joker can be any type of question. Except for a minigame.
Alright. No grunty question, so that's good.
So we want to get these Joker squares because they let us skip some squares, whatever ones we want. And the minigame squares just take really long to do. So it's better to just do a few extra squares, get Joker cards, and skip the minigames. In fact, if you get the Joker square wrong, it's actually faster to just die and then try Furnace Fun again. Alright, so there's the death square over and done with. We should be pretty safe now. So every one of these questions, he's getting these, checking what the most likely answer is, and then giving the calculator information about whether it was right or wrong. And then it'll keep narrowing down the possible patterns.
So right now we have three possible patterns. Wow, I'm getting really bad luck on this one. Alright.
Should have like one or two left now, I'd imagine. Oh, that's good. And Furnace Fun is pretty scary on 5 health as well, but honestly, if you die most of the time, it's from a death square or getting a Joker square wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, 5 health doesn't really make a lot of difference, but it can be intimidating.
Okay, two patterns. So we can't fail this, but no matter what that means. Oh no, we failed. Oh no, we're okay, we're okay.
So that's Furnace Fun skip. What happens with the death squares is they go to knock you off into the lava and kill you. And to do that, so there's usually invisible walls between any, like before any tiles that you haven't answered, but it has to take down all those walls so it can knock you off. So if you stand in such a spot that it'll knock you, try and knock you off, but you'll land back on the board, you gain control again, and all the walls are down, so you just walk through. And that saves a big cutscene at the end of Furnace Fun, and a bit more RNG. And here's Dog Skip.
Hopefully.
The end of this run is really brutal, because you got lots of RNG with Furnace Fun, and then Dog Skip right away. So this could be quick, or it could take ages. We'll just have to see.
Yeah. Hopefully it doesn't take ages. Nope. Okay, we're good. We're good. Oh my dog. Alright. Nice. So last thing. Grunty fight.
That's really impressive how quick that dog skip was. It's a very difficult trick.
Yeah.
And you'll notice that he just pecked the egg note door. Yeah, peck hitbox goes far enough in that it can just hit that egg refill and you get the refill and it's all good. So that's really handy, because otherwise we'd have to be collecting a lot more eggs through the whole run. And in the first phase of Grunty, you're supposed to kind of wait for her to fly back and forth a bunch of times and peck her once each. But if you poop a bunch of eggs at the start, then you can get all four of those hits in one shot, and it's a lot faster. Green homing spell. He's using that ground pound recoil to not get hit by it. You're supposed to use gold feathers, but the recoil from the ground pound makes you invincible as well. So you just use that and it's a little bit quicker. Even though it's completely different form of damage, it's the same exploit that he used to not take full damage in Click Lockwood.
I'm too close. Yeah. So, this is the second to last phase of this fight.
The difficult thing about any percentage, you have to do this whole 5 on 5 health.
But yeah. It makes
I'm
the...
I'm used to doing it, it's not that bad.
No, but it's definitely, as a beginner, it's like one of the hardest fights, just because of that 5 health issue.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, running any percent is a really good way to get good at this fight and do a lot of practice.
Alright, Gingenator time.
And before Gingenator, he was kind of looking away from those fireballs to produce a bit of lag as well.
Oh god. And time will be coming up right now. Alright, sorry for going overestimate, guys. That was kind of a really bad run.
Ah, that's still alright. I'm 138.47.
So, alright, cool. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
What do we have up next?
What do you want to say to the people?
Thank you guys all for watching. I'm sorry that, like, this run didn't go the best. Hopefully you'll, you know, check out some more Banjo runs in the future, though. What's up next on the schedule for us?
Up next is the Ace of Seafood.
Oh, that should be good.
Yeah, it's gonna be pretty sick. So, yeah.